All right, ladies and gentlemen, guests, friends, I am very happy to welcome you to our evening event. This is a discussion event. What economic model do we need is the title. It's sort of the overarching title that encompasses the criticism of the green economy. This is a book that Thomas Fatheuer, Lili Fuhr, and myself wrote. It was published in German last year, last November, and it is wonderful to see so many of you here today, and we are also pleased that even more people are watching us live on a live stream that is on the internet, and I would also like to welcome them. Hello, everybody listening to us on the live stream. Welcome from Berlin. So live stream is a possibility to increase the number of listeners even more. And I think this is a very good way, because today is the day where we are not only going to talk about the German version of the criticism of the green economy, but on the occasion of the publication of the English version. In English, the book is called Inside the Green Economy. We are happy to also have an international guest here today. That is Tim Jackson, the author of Prosperity Without Growth, a bestseller. The book was co-published by the Heinrich Böll Foundation. So, Tim, a warm welcome to you.
Alluding to the book with a preface, thank you very much. Und ich freue mich.
And I'm very happy to have Gerhard Schick here, member of the German Parliament. He represents Alliance 90, the Greens, and he's also an author of the book. Oh God, what was the title? Oh, Market Economy, No Thanks. So he's also here today to attend our discussion, and I think the titles of the book already indicate that the authors of the book have many things in common. We share that we are looking for an economic model that encompasses societal policy that manages to stick in the planetary boundaries on the one hand. On the other hand, this system should also be able to take up the old vision of modernity, that is democracy, human rights, and freedom. And these things have to be reconciled. This is not going to be easy, how we deal with freedom, human rights, and democracy, and democratic participation, and how to stay at the same time in the planetary boundaries. We addressed this challenge in our book. We very critically highlighted and analyzed the mainstream concepts of the green institutions and parties, like the World Bank, OECD, McKinsey, and others have reviewed them as well. The green economy has also been used by companies like Volkswagen. And with the criticism of the green economy, we would like to trigger a debate about what economic model we need. Because what we have heard, both theoretically and practically, from those who sort of grabbed the term the green economy, we are not convinced of those concepts. This is not the green economy that we want. My two co-authors, Lili Fuhr and Thomas Fatheuer, are looking forward to our discussion tonight because it is really the first time that we attend a book presentation together and that we discuss the thesis of the book. And the advantage of three authors, of course, is that everybody works in totally different contexts, and we have used the book in different contexts already in Germany and Austria and Switzerland. Wherever we go, the Inside the Green Economy book has been reviewed very well, so we got very good feedback. And now we are happy to have a discussion here with our international guest. We are going to discuss Inside the Green Economy also with other people tonight. I'm not going to delve into more detail, but I would like to, again, welcome all of you. And let me briefly tell you who is standing over there at this board. This is Anne Lehmann. She is doing graphic recording. So she's trying to capture the debate in a graphic mode tonight. And the result, after 2 hours, you will be able to enjoy downstairs after our discussion. So you can take a look whether you can identify elements of our discussion later. Anna, thank you very much for being here and for doing this. I'm really looking forward to seeing your result later. And then I would, of course, like to welcome Petra Pinsler. Petra Pinsler is an editor of the weekly Die Zeit. In her function, she works at the Berlin office. She's also the author of a very significant book from various significant books that deal with growth, criticism, and lifestyles. But she also wrote an important book on TTIP. And she's one of the few persons in Germany, in the mainstream media, that is, that has written something critical regarding TTIP. So welcome, Petra, and thank you very much for moderating this discussion tonight. Yeah, I would also like to welcome everybody. This is going to be an attempt. This is rather an unusual book presentation. I'm the only person who is allowed to stay here. All other panelists have to come up and leave again. We have about 2 hours, and here's the following plan. This book presentation will be divided into three different blocks. The first block is going to focus on the economic bases, like what does the green economy want? How can a different economic theory work? What could it look like? What are the problems and challenges? And then in a second block, we would like, and we will have three different participants, we would like to break things down, sort of, and delve into more details. The rebound effect, the technological optimism, where is it correct, where is it wrong, and why is it so difficult to discuss these things? And then finally, we are going to shed some light on the political dimension. And here's another idea. During these three blocks, if you have urgent questions, please write them on cards. They will be collected. And I will try to include your questions into the debate so that we can still focus on what we want to focus on. Of course, you will also get an opportunity to ask questions, but please write them down. You can also provide us with feedback later, that is after our three blocks in a Q&A. All right, now I would like to ask Tim Jackson, Gerhard Schick, and Thomas Fatheuer to join me here on stage. And while they are approaching the stage, let me briefly introduce Tim Jackson, bestseller author. I think everybody knows him. He wrote the book Prosperity Without Growth, and he revised the book, rather. He's going to lay a foundation for our discussion. And then he's going to discuss with Gerhard Schick and Thomas Fatheuer. They're going to discuss the book that has already been introduced.
Very brief, tell us, what is it and why is it a problem? You can just speak into the microphone and it should work.
I just speak and the words come out in one language or another.
I'm sorry for not giving my talk in German.
Anyway, it's a real pleasure to be here, and congratulations to Barbara and Lily and Thomas on the book. The green economy is a very strange beast. It is in part a kind of a promise. I think it began its life as a promise of a different kind of economy and a different kind of a society. And it very quickly became an object of controversy. It became actually a way in which, at least in the impression of a large number of people, mainstream economics and mainstream thinking colonized the radical edge. It began to be actually seen as a device, particularly, interestingly, by the G77 nations, the less developed nations, through the Rio Plus 20 conference. It began to be seen as a device for maintaining business as usual without really doing too much to change it, and at best, changing it only through technology. And to me, that is a shame. To me, it is a shame that the concept ended up in that way. And I do think to give the United Nations credit for what they started out to do. They began by that idea that the green economy is a promise. They began by the idea that actually it's possible to do things in a different way, to be more socially inclusive, to have more ecologically founded businesses, and to create change. And if they went wrong in that concept, it was also to some extent with the best of intentions, because I think they felt that they needed to pitch the green economy concept in a language that would bring the financial people to the table, that would bring the world leaders to the table. And if you look at the Green Economy Report, the Towards the Green Economy Report of the United Nations, you find actually the headline of the launch of that report was green growth, better growth, or something. Green growth is faster than brown growth, they called it. And so what they were essentially doing was appealing to the fact that there are some things that you can do in the economy that look like they're going to make the existing economy work even better in the way that it's always worked in the past. And it was almost an unfortunate mistake in a way, because it immediately cast the green economy as being the bad guy in a discussion between conventional and slightly more radical or alternative thinking. But when you delve down, if you do read the original Green Economy Report, what you find is actually a lot of much more sophisticated thinking. And it was almost like the advertising agency, the marketing department got hold of it and thought, this is the best way to brand the green economy, and they got it wrong. And the question I think that remains for us is the green economy still a promise, or is it simply a redundant concept?
Let me just ask Thomas. Thomas, der Grund, warum Sie sich damit...
Well, the reason for you having dealt with the green economy is that you've got some basic issues with this concept, saying that this isn't going that far, it's not far-sighted enough. Can you maybe be more precise on it? I think there are conceptual construction sites or issues in the green economy that point towards a wrong direction and that make for a wrong construction. So it's quite different from just being a promise. There's another point to it. The green economy picks up on something very important and very right, i.e. that the classic economy has failed when it comes to defining the relationships between the economy and nature. So the classic way, or the conventional way of doing economics, has not involved nature adequately and builds on destroying nature. And the answer, which is not a new one, picked up on by the green economy, is the following. Yes, nature is regarded as being an external effect, something externalized. So now we have to internalize those impacts on the economy. So internalizing means choosing price and other economic mechanisms, and thus involving nature in economics. And we believe that this is a basic mistake, because it takes as a prerequisite that nature can be integrated in the economy, and not the other way around, i.e. that the economy has to be integrated into nature. The question is, what is the decisive system here? And the green economy, as it was depicted by Barbara, also understand it differently, refers to the conventional mainstream concept and sticks to the idea that prices and internalizing things will actually be the solution when it comes to our relationship with nature. And I think this is basically our criticism. So we have to take a closer look. And then we find that this doesn't actually work and wouldn't point to the right direction. Why wouldn't it work? Just two sentences. I mean, there are Nobel Prize winners in economics saying that animals are protected if they are awarded a prize. Well, actually, I lived in Brazil for a long time. I would not, for instance, use a prize to internalize the destruction of the rainforest, saying that it has to, but I would say it has to be stopped. And we could choose other examples like animal breeding, mass animal breeding. And we would have to achieve a consensus in society not to want any of that. And I think the price mechanism wouldn't help us here. Let me just give you another example, which is very brief but very telling. The Federal Office for the Environment carried out a survey across Europe, studying the ecological cost of car traffic, something which is actually very well measurable because the economists can actually calculate and analyze everything. This is also a benefit and drawback of economists. So when it comes to the ecological cost of driving a car, then CO2 emissions and noise emissions and increased mortality are included. And what's the result? What's the basic figure? 2.9 cents per kilometer. This is the ecological cost of driving a car. But is that what we want? 2.9 cents to top that? So top the price of CO2, but what's that going to change? And if we take a closer look, we can find that nothing much will change. And we can see that behind those mechanisms, and we can provide other examples for it, we will facilitate business as usual with just a slight modification. Gerhard Schick, you're one of the few green persons that are really taken seriously by the banks. What about it? I mean, did the green economy lead to a situation where banks started and economists started to rethink nature and think about nature differently? Or would you say it didn't just work out because what Tim told us just before is that they tried to put it in language for people, for bankers to understand, for people that deal with money to understand? Well, I believe that some people understood more about it, but maybe for different reasons. But let me just up front thank you very much for the book, and thank you very much for having me tonight. This is one of the books where you get problems reading because you're nodding so much because you approve of it so much. But still, I would like to put one thing up front because it's important for tonight's event. I do have an issue with these terms used here because for my liking, it's as if somebody tried to snatch out terms that we use, and now this creates some vague notion of what we're arguing about. I think we criticize the concept of green capitalism. Green capitalism is something that can't work for my liking, and this is quite straightforward, because if the overriding entity that accumulates everything, if everything is financial capital, everything that's decisive, then actually the motive is not the needs of society or what society needs and what is its basis for life, but I can imagine a green market economy without any problem, a green market economy in which the players, the stakeholders, could be cooperative companies, municipal companies, family-owned or individually-owned companies, respecting the needs of the population, and they internalize the fact that we need fresh air to breathe, for instance. And I can imagine this to come true in a very sound way. So I think for the sake of terminology, it's important to state what we are criticizing. And if I'm not mistaken, then it's the following point. Some people are just trying to sell to us a green capitalism, and the failed capitalist hypothesis, i.e. that if we've got more capital, then we will feel better and better, are proven wrong in any financial crisis. So here we all agree green capitalism is doomed to fail. I was always against it, and I think the Greens have to be positioned in a more anti-capitalist fashion. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. But it's not anti-market economy style. I mean, we can maybe flesh this out later on. Regarding the banks, of course, there's some that as soon as we put a price on something, sign a price to something or trade something, become enthusiastic. And for instance, about the CO2 market, and you can get a whole lot of ideas about certificates, about opening derivatives, about engaging in fraud, etc. And you can also design the market in such a way that it crashes, just like many other financial markets all the same. But there are also people, and we shouldn't overlook this fact, people understood that doing without coal makes sense, economically speaking, for themselves as investors, because it simply doesn't work anymore on the basis of coal. And of course, in the economy, there are also people that think beyond the tip of their nose and aware of the fact that if the Paris Agreement doesn't work out, then our whole business model will just fail and collapse, because as soon as we really experience climate change in an even harsher way, and I think this is what we're facing, for instance, that agriculture will no longer work the way we know it, and of course there are people that we could be faring together here. Tim, what Gerhard Schick just tried to outline here was to criticize one term by introducing a new one, the green market economy. But market economy is a very German term, which in the Anglo-Saxon context is not something well understood. But is that something that you would agree to? Would this be the alternative to green capitalism? Would this be the way to head towards?
We stand in a really difficult situation, and we have to be honest about that, that actually the incumbent system is going to try to colonize language. And the green economy doesn't start by suggesting green capitalism, but it ended up there because actually the incumbent system colonized the language, they colonized the concepts, they translated them into things like green taxes that would be easily internalized in the existing mindset, and the language could then speak to the captains of industry, the captains of finance. And that is a process that is both frustrating and inevitable, that language actually will move as we try to move the terminology forward. And I think it's a challenge that as those who want to transform that system must always be aware of, that if we, you know, introduce a term like green in front of anything else, and it looks like the right direction, then any number of people will stand up and say, yes, I'm a green capitalist, a green market economist, whatever. And that actually being aware of that process of language is an important part of transformation. One of the areas, and I don't agree everywhere with the degrowth movement, but I think it is very relevant here, because what the degrowth movement has done is to take the central concept of growth and to put a negative sign in front of it and say, actually, this is our language shift. Get out of that, you bastards, if you can. This is the way that we're going to... Can I say that? It's we're live on any number of live streams everywhere, but it's in this context, it means... It's like sticking a certain digit up. No, I can't do that either, really, can I? It's like saying there is a system here that you guys are trying to destroy, and we somehow are trying to transform. And if you think you can capture this language, the language of degrowth in this case, then by all means have a go at it. Now, what's interesting about that is that the green economy guys, in a sense, have a much, much bigger audience than the degrowth guys. But what's happened is that the language has been colonized, absorbed, and it's been transformed into something that no longer expresses the opposite. What is the response to the degrowth movement? It is essentially to demonize it. To say the language itself is nasty, it doesn't work, it's not something that I'm attracted to, it doesn't bring me into the debate, it divides people rather than bringing them together in transformation. And somewhere between those two things is a strategy that is cognizant of the fact that language itself is a part of the transformation that we have to engage in.
Where will you put yourself in between the degrowth and the green economy guys?
The green growth and the degrowth movement, I'm usually in an extremely uncomfortable position. You know, I'm some guy who stood up in no man's land and is being shot at from both sides. And that is, you know, that's the
nice
experience
position
of it, really. And what I do, I suppose what I try to do is to play a language game. And the language game that I attempt to play is one in which we can use words and transform words like prosperity. It's almost like going into the enemy territory and capturing a bit of their language and pulling it back and saying, actually, no, prosperity is not just endless growth. It's something different. Well-being is not just the expansion of the economy. It's our development as human beings. And that, interestingly, is a message that it can be still captured, but it has a wider appeal to people's instinctive understandings of the good life, of what society should be.
Actually, one of the reasons I think of this book is to kind of push people exactly into this direction. But could you actually offer them something more than critique? Would you say there is already something like a concept of economy that people could use then and refer to them?
Yeah, there clearly is. I mean, to me, It's a series of very precise tasks, and we've all been engaged in them to some extent, even you, Petra, in creating the idea, first of all, that well-being is a very broadly defined concept, that it isn't easily mapped onto having lots more stuff, that it isn't easily mapped onto an existing market system, that it doesn't mean the same thing as endless expansion of the economic output. So that's, you know, that's the first task. And in some ways, that's the easy ground, because even politicians will eventually understand that. And some of them have already stood up and said, yeah, you know, the GDP doesn't really measure the quality of our life. Robert Kennedy said it in 1968. You know, it's not a new idea. And then having taken that idea, I think our job is firstly to avoid the colonization of language, firstly to avoid being tugged back into the mainstream, but secondly to be incredibly constructive about what that economy looks like. What does its enterprise look like? What's the role of people in work, in labor, in such an economy? How does investment work? Does it work in any kind of way whatsoever? How does the money system work in this new economy? To take the basic building blocks that we have taken for granted in a conventional system and say, transform them, you know, reach into the territory, take out the word, turn it inside out and put in place the building blocks of a different economy.
One of the tasks of the foundation is not just to delve into criticism, but to develop something else. Would you agree with Tim that there is enough that you can offer beyond the criticism of the green economy? Well, I think there's a whole host of things that we can offer. Maybe there is not the big leap regarding a new society, but that's not tragic. I think the alternatives that are out there can be seen in different areas, and people, social movements, but also individuals create them. We have alternatives, for instance, in the area of agriculture. We do see quite a few alternatives in the area of agriculture. What is missing is the power to put alternatives into practice. Political influencing possibilities, the lobby, these are weak. Take a look at urban development. Take a look at traffic and transport. We do see a lot of alternative options, and I think we have to strengthen and push them. But please don't think or don't be an illusionist. If you take a look at the transport sector, this is a recurrent theme here in our book. We focus on the car very often because one of the small surprises when I did some research was the following. Actually, two things. Firstly, how strongly the share of car production in Germany's GDP has risen. There is a table in the book. I mean, you can take a look at the numbers, but there's always this discussion about industrialization. Everything is being outsourced. We do see processes being outsourced, but the automotive industry has become much more powerful in Germany as a consequence. And consequently, we have a huge automotive lobby. And this is the second number, which is very surprising. Volkswagen is the corporation which invests most in innovation. It's not Google. It's not a technology company, but it's Volkswagen. And then they produce those diesel engines that we all had and used, and then this software behind it. So they really love innovation, Volkswagen. And to take a look at their power and then do something against this is our task. So it's not the problem that we don't see enough alternatives. Yeah, the question of political power will be discussed later. But Gerhard Schick, let us go one step back. Let us focus on what Thomas Fatoya said in the beginning, this huge criticism, so this valorization of nature, that we assign a price to nature. Would you say that this makes sense? And does the criticism of the green economy make sense consequently? Or should you just recognize and accept that a CO2 price makes sense? Or should we go back to German regulatory law because the green market economy can only prevail then? And a valorization of nature, in the end, is the wrong tool. What do you think?
Well, I would say that
you should never generalize things. It's not convincing. So CO2 taxation does make sense. I think it is good because it comes down to something that we cannot completely abolish. There will always be CO2, but we have too many CO2 emissions. So assigning a price to CO2 can result in a deduction of CO2 emissions. However, there are other questions and issues where I wouldn't come up with pricing. There are certain toxic chemicals, for instance, that have to be totally abolished. And here I need regulatory law. And then the question always is, what does that mean for ownership rights? I mean, many things that we discuss under the term of financialization implies that so far free resources that didn't belong to an individual, but maybe to a community, so a certain rainforest area, for instance, all of a sudden are allocated with land titles. So this land is sold to somebody, and these people are deprived of their lands and territories. Now, there's another factor that you have to consider. Pricing only works if we also deal with the distribution issue. Because if half of society is so rich that they don't care about a CO2 price, they can still go on airplanes and fly to the other end of the world. And if the other half of society is so poor that they cannot pursue avoidance strategies to have better insulated windows, for instance, if they don't have any money, then CO2 pricing doesn't really make sense. Therefore, the question of ecological pricing has to be connected with the issue of distribution. Very important point. Now, then the question of, do we have the concepts? I'm a little more sober, to be honest, in the individual sectors, agricultural transition, etc. But I also think that we have concepts for financial markets and a financial transition, but when it comes to the core question of how do we manage the transition to an economy with very low or zero growth rates, how can we organize this transition in a way that things will not explode or collapse on our way there? So far, I have not yet seen any good and credible alternative that I could build on. And it would be nice to get something from research or academia that we can use in order to develop policies, because the demand for degrowth is quickly done. But now I have to ask myself, okay, if a decrease of growth rates always resulted in an increase in unemployment, an increase of debts, if many municipalities can no longer make investments, then this means that if there is no growth or degrowth, that there will be huge problems. And we also need to shed light on low interest rates and low growth. There is a connection between the two. I have the impression that we need more input from science. It would be wonderful to read a corresponding or respective book or article. Thomas Fatheuer, before I chase you away and you will be replaced by Lily Fuhr, would you like to make one last statement? Well, I can just subscribe to what has just been said. I don't disagree here. Therefore, the transformation perspective is what we are focusing on in the book. And it's not a ready-made concept or goal. It is still a work in progress. Of course, many things still need to be done, goes without saying. But I think in many areas, and this is what really we focused on in the book, so there are alternatives, there are concrete proposals, but we cannot make the next step because we don't have the political power. So we are discussing transformation prospects, but we cannot even abolish SUVs from our roads. We cannot even get a VAT for meat. We discuss all kinds of different issues, but we cannot make the next step. And I think a lot still needs to be done before we master huge transformation and degrowth challenges. We cannot do this right now. This is sort of a vision for the future, but we have to make other steps first. Okay, thank you very much. Please now pass the mic to Lily Fuhr. Yes, please. Give him a hand. Okay, a word has just been mentioned that we would like to discuss, feasibility. I think this is one of the buzzwords that the green economy likes using, so the belief that most problems can be used with technologies. Why is that wrong? Well, we have learned when looking at the different green economy concepts, but also the implementation in practice, that one thing is shared by every concept. It is this incredible security and safety that we will be able to find technological solutions for everything in the future. I think we know many examples of the past where technologies did not live up to the promises, where they did certain things but had terrible side effects. I think we can think of all kinds of different examples. Nuclear energy would be one. But it's really incredible what power this has in the discourse. One example that really moved me most in my climate policy work. It is so-called negative emissions. What you will know probably is that our global CO2 budget is actually exhausted. If we take the Paris Agreement seriously, if we take the global seriously to reduce or to keep global warming at 1.5 degrees centigrade compared with the industrial level of 1990, then we would have to stop burning coal tomorrow. I mean, climate scientists know that, and the IPCC sketches different scenarios. They calculate how we can achieve those political goals. And now, in the preparation to the climate summit in Paris, it became clear that all these scenarios that focus on 2 degrees or 1.5 degrees entail a concept which is called negative emissions, because the scientists were confronted with a problem of creating scenarios. But people said, please don't question our global growth model. And what did the climate scientists say? They said, oh, then we have to let emissions exceed the boundaries or the thresholds, and then we will have magic technologies that will suck out CO2 from the atmosphere. This is sort of the basic idea of the IPCC scenarios. And on this basis, we formulated the political goals at the climate summit in Paris. So there are very concrete ideas in terms of what to do with CO2, to dump it in the seas, or what else. I mean, these ideas do exist, don't they? Yeah. Biomass, CCS, these are the ideas that are discussed most. So we plan biomass, plants, trees, etc. And the territory that we would need in order to achieve 2 degrees centigrade is India twice, or twice the agricultural fields that we have at the moment. The idea is that we plant biomass on those fields, burn it, use the energy, and then store it in the soil forever. And we'll do this forever. This is the climate policy mainstream response to 1.5 degrees centigrade. And this is, of course, a political challenge.
Fixes.
I absolutely agree with Lily and with what the book says in relation to technofixes. I wanted to come back though to the question of feasibility and in particular feasibility in relation to a low or no growth environment, because that the context of that has changed actually within the last decade, and many people think that that's to do with the financial crisis and that we're still living somehow with the instability of the financial crisis and a low growth environment because we had the financial crisis. But actually, if you do, as Gerhard was suggesting, looking in a more scientific way at the progress of capitalist economies over the last 100 years, let's say, you would find a very, very interesting phenomenon that technology worked by increasing labor productivity massively between the year 1900 and the middle of the 19th century. But since the middle of the 19th century, the growth in labor productivity has declined, almost as massively, to the point where in my country, actually, the labor productivity growth has been negative in recent years. And in most, across most advanced economies, the labor productivity growth is less than 0.5% per annum. Now, that's a situation in which actually the growth model, the one we thought we would get out of all these problems with, isn't there anymore. We can't appeal to it. It is an environment in which actually we have to confront the feasibility question. We have to say, what does the economy look like when you don't have this growth anymore? And you have to address the problems of employment, of financial instability, of the structure of the money system that arise when you're looking at an economy in which you can no longer rely on the promise of increasing growth forever. Now, that is a very interesting place to be, partly because it elicits this argument about technology in two very different ways. The first way is to appeal to the power of technology as being able to save us and to reclaim our growth rates. But actually, the green economy and what green economy wants to do with technology is something very different. It doesn't want to save our growth rates. It wants to protect our planet. And so it immediately defines a very different kind of technology. But the other thing that it also does is it begins to feed back on itself. As Lily has said, and it's absolutely right, these are, for the most part, imaginary technologies, negative emission technologies. We appeal to the belief that they will be there when we need them. But if you really do accept a 1.5 degree target, that means we need them now or yesterday or at 6 years' time at most, when the carbon budget is completely exhausted and we have nothing to deliver our electricity systems, to power our industrial systems, to create the products that we need to flourish as a society, to make our markets work in the way that we did, to keep our assets buoyant in the way that the financial system needs it to be. It's all, you know, actually a fundamental economic problem now, as well as an ecological problem and as well as a social problem. And this really it strengthens, it underlines, it even exaggerates the critique that you've made in the book of the green economy, because the economy itself is not taking the problem seriously enough. It's appealing to a kind of imaginary technology that will come and save us, deus ex machina, as though such a thing were possible. And instead, what we should be doing is exactly what Gerhard was challenging us to do, and Thomas as well, is actually create the feasibility of a post-growth economy. We don't have to engage with the language of that. We don't have to say that we're degrowthists. We don't have to pin our badge to the green economy. We don't have to appeal to the growth motive anymore, because actually that argument is over. The argument now is how to recreate an economic system that works in radically different circumstances: climate, social inequality, financial stability, and economies that just seem to resist the growth that we thought we would have forever.
Herr Schick, ich würde trotzdem gerne noch mal einen Augenblick bei der Frage der Hoffnung an die.
Mr. Schick, let's stick to that question about hoping for better technologies. I mean, the way we're sitting here, we often say that we won't be able to come to terms with everything with the help of technologies only, but when discussing in other fora, then people tend to think differently. Or would you think that this has arrived in the mainstream of society? If you read the programs of the Green Party, then we seem to believe that growth and technology can help us to sort out any kind of problem, or am I wrong? Well, I'd say that even in the Heinrich-Böll Foundation, there are advocates of technological solutions exclusively to these problems. And I think we have to deal with that kind of idea. And of course, there are two traps you can step in. One is believing that technology can solve everything. This is politically attractive, and then you can visit companies, innovative companies like I did today, which is intriguing, that purify water or that recycle products in so many times that it looks quite clean, or that use exhaust fumes from a manufacturer like BASF to generate electricity, for instance. So this is torched and to generate electricity, and politicians would say, well, this is highly appealing for our society. And the other trap is the following. having a critical stance towards technology, saying, well, it's all going to work only if we do without things, because I think it won't work. We've got so many things inherent to our societal structure, so many products we use every day, that if we used less or fewer of these products, we wouldn't even get to a situation that is desirable, because many of the structures that we built up have forced us into a way of living that is very intense in CO2. So this is why I believe that it is decisive to raise the question as to whether we can launch a technological development that actually lives up to the needs of our society, i.e. that can find a solution to the CO2 issue, to the biodiversity issue, to nitrogen in our groundwater. And I think here the role of government has to be underlined. So our society and government have to play a stronger role, sending an impetus and being courageous enough to make technological leaps as well. So many people would say, well, you believe too much in the state. No, it's just division of labor, because the individual activities carried out by companies won't be able to bring about a major societal change, but it will be incremental steps. And I think the weakness in investment has got something to do with that precisely, i.e. that in Berlin's buildings, there is too little courage to actually take innovative, future-oriented decisions for our society, and not just do business as usual. Because unless I've got ideas as to where we're headed, I think the risk for me as a private investor, as a private entrepreneur who has an idea, is way higher, because he wouldn't know whether it would match with what would happen. And some infrastructures, well, there's a British economist that did it brilliantly with an M. You got it? Yeah, gave a very important impetus to Labour Party. And I'm just reading the book, which is highly fascinating. I mean, showing that all innovative feats developed by Google or Apple were financed and funded in government-run research entities and government subsidies. And of course, the major infrastructures that are available to us are due to government-led decisions. And we couldn't just go from A to B with little CO2 emissions unless we had that railway network. And you can't do it as a private person. But in what way does the criticism of the green economy have a counter-model like this one, Lily, for? I mean, last week, I attended an event where somebody said that the technology provided by Uber could also create a situation where in rural areas people got together and share a car so as to avoid traffic instead of supporting jobs that are not liable to social security benefits. So you can use technology for communities or for the opposite of that. Well, what is crucial here is that we're not saying that we wouldn't need any innovation anymore, that we wouldn't need any technology anymore. This is important for me to say. So we definitely need innovations, social and ecological transformation needs, new knowledge. And what we have to do is to rediscover old knowledge. We need the most diverse knowledge and different systems of knowledge. The problem is that we've got a very narrow debate about purely technological innovation. And in many areas, at least where I'm active in, we pursue environmental debates. It's about other technologies that influence ecosystems in a planetary context, and we can't even predict their influences. So what we need, at any rate, is the most diverse types of innovations. And if we describe problems, we always have to reflect upon political solutions, and also we have to think about the part that technology has to play. And for the most part, we do have those technologies. We will need some new technologies for the next time to come. And by way of enhancing our knowledge in the sense of the commons as well, we can be more innovative than by having research instruments funded by large companies. Can you give us precise examples, specific examples, please? Well, there are a number of digital communities that have created a network all across the globe so as to develop innovations together. It can be software applications, or it can also be new means of transport, can be new systems for compost toilets, for instance. But it is always matching the needs of somebody. So they first analyze where there's a problem and whom to give the technology and make it available to everyone, not isolating it, not recoiling, but making it accessible for everyone to build on, to further develop it.
State has to play in a different role in this kind of economy where innovation is an innovation not just for a private firm, but for society?
Yes, I absolutely do. I mean, the concept of an appropriate technology has been there for decades, four decades at least, and appropriateness is about the needs that the technology serves, its impact on the environment, the ability to disseminate and develop it, and indeed the governance that that technology demands. And Mariana Mazzucati's work is, as you say, incredibly interesting, because she basically says, you know, these wonderful technology advances for which the benefits have largely been to the public, to the private sector, to a minority, were funded in their development by the public sector, by government. Now, if you think clearly about that message, it actually extends itself quite broadly through the structure of what we like to think of as a capitalist market economy, where we basically privatize benefits and socialize costs. And that is exactly, in a way, what the Apple example shows. But it extends itself beyond that. We privatize the benefits from the extraction of mineral resources and coal, and we socialize the costs of that because they fall on the public purse, on future debt, on other generations that we will never even know. And so that process of privatizing benefit and socializing cost is one of the transformative things that we have to think about in changing the economy. And the one thing that comes very, very clearly out of that is the role of governance. And perhaps we'll talk a little bit more when Barbara's on the podium about that. But it does seem absolutely clear that a simple divide that says, you know, here's a statist solution and here's a market solution was never even the case. It was just a chimera. It was an illusion that we created so that we could have very clever, very vicious arguments with each other about capitalism and socialism. And actually, now is the time to reach into that language, pull out governance, and say, actually, this is the constructive role that government can play, that the state can play.
Ich will gerne noch mal auf diese Innovationssache.
I'd like to pick up on the idea of innovation. I believe that the question as to which technology to choose is something we often take for granted. Or it's just like in the old growth models where the technology is just coming out of the blue. But it's not the case, actually. But the question is, how can we organize things in such a way that we've got the technological innovations at hand that will allow us to live in a decent way, respecting our environment? And I think we have to achieve this together. And governments play a role here, but it also requires actions of civil society and intriguing innovations that actually can be traced back to civil society. It's like in the 1970s. Well, it's not about the state doing everything on its own, but there are just a few things that, in terms of infrastructures, have to be provided by the state. But, of course, a major role has to be played by an innovative civil society and non-profit entities, and also private investment. I wouldn't play off one against the other, but I would actually share roles or divide labor here. And when making a call in favor of an ecological and sustainable economy, we have to bear in mind the innovative change that this implies, which has to be different from the innovative change that we've been experiencing over the past couple of years, because it just aspired to accumulating capital for large companies and that reached out to funding university research and piloted a number of things in such a way. So there's a lot of research going on, but strangely enough, nobody's ever giving answers to the most basic questions. My job is always to make sure that this is going to be as precise as possible. Please imagine you are Minister of Economics. What would be an area that you would change, maybe, or a research minister? I think that the so-called sharing economy is at a crossroads. We have to decide whether it's only the capital-oriented solutions that will make their way through, or whether we would be able to create structures in which the decentralized, non-for-profit aspect prevails. And I think this has to be our focus, i.e. we have to make sure that digital innovation serve our society as a whole. And I believe this is our focal point. And we can actually look at it when we discuss about riding a bicycle, and you can maybe rent a bike via an application on your cell phone. But the question is this just available in a few large cities, or can we maybe roll it out to rural areas as well? Will we be able to create a whole structure? And I think this is just an example of things we can make available to municipalities in terms of infrastructures. Lily? Yeah, and in this research agenda, I would wish for research institutions to get networked with others that ask themselves what the requirements in terms of energy needs are and how we can cover these. Well, yes, that's important, because the rebound effect often destroys things. And for this not to happen, there has to be something somewhere that tells us, well, maybe it's not technology path A or technology path B, and it can't be decided by Parliament, but it's a societal question. Ensuring that, summing it up, pursuant to all technological changes, we won't consume even more natural resources. And this is what we haven't achieved over the past couple of years, despite all the great technological progress we've had. Anything I forgot, Lily Foyle, maybe? I would like to make one more point. We just discussed about the colonialization of our language in this context. And I would like to state that there's also something like colonizing our way of thinking, our mental infrastructures, our mindset infrastructures. This is also a motto of the degrowth movement, by the way, discussing about how we can decolonize our mental infrastructure to find new solutions. And one example that is quite straightforward is also traffic, car traffic. I mean, in Germany at least, we've got these mental infrastructures that are actually marked by motorized individual transport. And if we can't get rid of these structures and leave innovations to the large companies of the automotive industry, we wouldn't find anything else but electromobility, or maybe undergrounds and Uber, maybe, and nothing else but that. Well, yeah, my son as well, he preferred the car over public transport as well. That's what you're talking about. Well, buses could have been a solution, but not been that far. But I'm learning as well. But now, Barbara Unmüßig, I'd like to ask you to come up on stage, and please give a round of applause to Lily Foyle. Well deserved.
Okay, we arrived at the research minister already. Gerhard Schick was a research minister at least for a few seconds. And this brings us to the third and last part of the debate. How can we now merge everything into politics? We talked about the recolonization of thinking, but it's not that easy, as we have learned in Germany. Tim, the degrowth movement in Germany exists, but it is not on people's radar here in Berlin, or is that wrong? What would you say? Well, I wouldn't say in Berlin. I think people do know the degrowth movement here, but it's not political mainstream. What needs to be done, Barbara? Well, first of all, we, in our final chapter of the book, come up with a pledge for the repoliticization of the ecological policy. And this links up to, and I was a young woman in the 1970s and 80s, to political ecology. Because I think that the ecological movement and the ecological debate lost something, and that is growth, critical debates, and power issues and justice issues. I think they never really dealt with these issues. What we have seen is that a more radical ecological movement of the 1970s theoretically talked about ecological issues and the future. They didn't think so much about environmental technologies. They thought about societal and social contexts, where it was about identifying the preventers, who prevents alternatives from being put into practice, who prevents reform alternatives becoming feasible, although they already exist. So we definitely have to deal with the repoliticization of the ecological debate. We have to intensively deal with that and include power issues, justice issues, distribution issues. We have to get those issues back into the ecological debate. Because I also hear this when talking to young people. Young people think that the Green Party is an environmental party, a party that just focuses on environmental protection, a party that just wants to change a few things regarding the running system. They want to reduce CO2 emissions, they say. But this basic idea of the relationship between men and the system and the economy. I mean, these things sort of got lost. People don't think about this anymore.
Sound correct, but if I try to translate what we just heard, the meaning basically is you can only be green if you're on the left. Is that true?
Because the sense of a meaningful government only exists on the left?
No, because you have to think about...
I'm just trying to be clear. I'm not making a statement. I think it is a challenge to the right, to be perfectly honest. But I also think there are some aspects of the debate that are a challenge to the left. What we're talking about challenges both left and right. And needs to reinvigorate, and I think this is absolutely right, the discussion about governance and to politicize that debate. I'm not meaning politicize in the sense of let's take line up the positions of all the different colored parties as to where they are, but actually to acknowledge that there is a fundamental politicization within the debate about the green economy. And so it has to deal with fundamental questions of inequality, of getting rid of poverty, of obscene wealth in the minority. It has to deal with that social terrain. It has to deal with the question of property rights. It has to say, are we in a business which creates more and more property rights and allows them to be accumulated in private hands? Or are we in the business of saying, actually, this is all belongs to the state and we look after it all? And the reality is that neither of those positions, either left or right, is going to be successful in what we need to achieve. And actually, there has to be, in a sense, a kind of opening out of that politicized dialogue to say which bits of left and right actually might work here to create a concept of governance that is actually workable in the context that we find ourselves. And I don't believe that sits easily on left and right. I would probably agree that it sits a bit more easily on the left than it does on the right. But actually, in between those positions are positions where one redefines property rights, when one talks about common property, where one talks about common pool resources. Eleanor Ostrom, the first ever woman to win a Nobel Prize in economics, laid that concept very clearly on the table. And what's fascinating about Eleanor Ostrom's work is, firstly, that she is widely acknowledged, lionized even, by the Greens, because she talks about common pool resources in a really clear way and about the importance of managing those and the fact that you can't always manage those through the market. But she also says, absolutely rightly, you can't always manage them through top-down statist solutions. You have to find this diaspora, this place where you have migrants from left and right, where you have migrant in intellectual ideas, where you create new senses of ownership, of common and worker ownership, perhaps in some places, of national ownership in other places, because these are really important social goods that you have to protect, of private ownership in other places where there are efficient working markets at local level to keep those forces in control. This is not a red or blue or green or black and white politics anymore, and it really does call for us to reinvigorate the argument about the types of governance that can work actually to protect our interests and to protect the future of the planet.
Gerhard Schick, ist das tatsächlich die Richtung, in die man weiter...
Mr. Schick, is that really the right direction that you have to think of beyond right and left, this term commons, common good, common well-being, so that then allows for mixed versions? I think that has always been the right approach. An approach that doesn't focus on the big private power constellations and concentrations, and that don't focus on the state concentrations either. The green approach, and you can see it when you look at the beginning of the green movement in Germany, was against the nuclear companies and against the nuclear state. And if you want to have such a political independence, then you, of course, also need strong analyses and clarity in terms of what you do. And you have to deal with these two poles in a reasonable way. And I think this can only work if you take and or summon up the courage and tell private companies what is happening right now. Market economy is not involved here. It has nothing to do with market economy, what we are observing nowadays. We see one mega merger after the next. So more and more companies hold bigger and bigger shares. And the influence of those companies on the state, on academia, on jurisdiction, on our opinion formation and the media is not good for a free society, all of that. But you also have to say that this state does no longer render decent services to its citizens anymore. Unfortunately, we did not highlight this enough. And unfortunately, we also left this argument to others, which is very unfortunate. This is something that the state has to do again, that is, render these services. And if we summon up the courage to really break it down to the different elements and communicate it accordingly as a liberal ecological power that is independent. But you cannot write this down at a party convention. No, you have to fill it with life and really live it. Yeah, wonderful. And thank you, Gerhard, that you raised the power issue regarding the political and the economic world. Thank you for highlighting how everything is intertwined here. And you also raise these issues in Parliament, and we are very grateful for that. Currently, we are observing one of the biggest mergers in the German industry. Bayer buys Monsanto, becomes the biggest agrochemical corporation in the world. I think we can't prevent this anymore. We have seen many good demonstrations against it, but they didn't have any negotiating power. The antitrust authorities allow for that in Germany. We only have 5 supermarket chains nowadays. They control our food. 90% of our food is controlled by 5 supermarket chains. 5 years ago, it was 70%, and we still had 9 supermarket chains. So we are observing how these mergers are happening, how these monopolies emerge and oligopolies emerge. They are happening right in front of our eyes, and we feel powerless. We feel helpless. I think we haven't yet developed a recipe as to how to deal with it. And this brings me to the governance issue. What will we do if, or what are we doing if we see these power tendencies, these tendencies of companies exerting pressure on the political sector, and they sort of blackmail the political sector nowadays. And in this case, I would like to ask you, representing the political sector, what tools do we have? Antitrust law is not enough. Maybe with Edeka, Tengelmann, Kaisers, these supermarkets, maybe there it is enough. But other than antitrust law, we do not have any governance instruments in order to put an end to these power processes. Internationally, I have to say, it's very nice, by the way, that many heads of the Bell Foundation's offices are here. We have many directors here today. There is no region where we as the foundation are active that is not in a dramatic situation when it comes to companies influencing governments, where we saw progress like in Latin America. The situation is changing as well. The old oligarchs now exert their influence again. I don't want to sketch a bleak picture here, but I'm asking myself, how do we want to overcome the ecological crisis? Because we are confronted with a political crisis at the same time. How can we master all these challenges? And in Europe and globally, we have a political crisis. And we see right-wing populist parties and right extremist parties everywhere. We do not have a global debate regarding this power concentration, but we have to have this debate, get such a debate. Well, I have my doubts regarding how to make these demands a little more concrete. What we have seen is repoliticization in certain areas against CETA or TTIP, for instance, or on the right, in very unpleasant ways. So a politicization against something is obviously working. But what you are demanding and what we are demanding is a concrete positive utopia. Well, I think you cannot tell society that they should become more political according to our wishes. Unfortunately, that is not going to work. But I think there are concrete measures that you can implement or that can be put into practice. You do not have to allow for construction law for having huge agricultural factories. I mean, construction law should not allow for special solutions for those huge agricultural factories. One third of agricultural farms disappeared as a consequence in the last 10 years. You don't have to allow for that in construction law. Antitrust law can also be exacerbated. You can reduce tax privileges. You can also reduce companies' influence on politics. I mean, if you know what is happening on financial markets in the government, you should not allow for other companies to influence that instead of trying to understand what is happening on those markets. We, as a society, accepted the state to be diminished and it didn't stay at eye level. And I think the challenge, or the chance rather, that I see is that we have to manage to get certain across in certain areas. With the water privatization campaign, we were successful. The TTIP campaign has been successful. It's not going to be successful in each and every area, but this is encouraging. And it is important to put an end to the globalization of power structures by developing a different narrative. And this means that Greens in Germany have to try to be very clear if basic protests are not happening in Germany, but in other countries, yet they affect German companies. I think we sometimes focus too much on our states, on our municipalities. So I think we have to broaden our horizon. And when it comes to the repoliticization, the question of where do we want to go, what is an alternative to an economy which is controlled by a few big companies. I mean, this debate has to become more appealing. And I see that we still have to develop many concepts, because in a world where we are daily confronted with Apple and Google, it is not that easy to really think about other things and say, I'm still doing well. And this is something that we have to achieve.
Ja, vielleicht nur noch mal als konkretes Beispiel.
Let me give you one very specific example where regulation could take place if there were enough political will here in Germany to do so. Currently, in Germany, there are negotiations going on as to whether we would receive a national action plan that translates the UN guidelines for human rights to German law. And this got something to do with the fact that at last somebody could impose and prescribe how German companies that are active abroad in the textile industry or in the mining industry that are actually responsible for human rights violations are bound by due diligence regulations and have to be held accountable and have to provide reports. And this is something that we don't achieve because the German Federation of the Industry and of Employers resist so much and carry out such a massive lobby work so that we're not able actually to transpose UN law into German law. And these are the factors we have to deal with that influences and even caps on emissions to be imposed on the German automotive industry are sometimes impeded in Brussels and very violently so. So our citizens can hardly be active in all the hotspots where political regulations are actually prevented right now. I mean, we can hardly ever be present everywhere as citizens. We don't manage to do that. So we have to maybe think about a larger shift in politics and transformation, which provides for greater regulatory power and more instructions to be imposed on our businesses to display due diligence and respect human laws, and our state also has to protect human rights and has to foster this. Tim?
It is a difficult situation, and an appeal to incumbent concepts of government. It's tempting to believe that is almost doomed to failure. But I think the appropriate point to start is actually not to say, you know, should we have more regulation here, or how could we lobby for more regulation there, or should we internalize this tax, or should we have a massive campaign for a tax change, but actually to ask the question, why has government been captured by these interests to the extent that there is a huge sense of disempowerment of democracy, almost pulling the rug entirely out of the concept of democracy and leaving nothing in its place but disillusion, apathy, and in some cases, violent protest. And when we ask those questions in that way, I mean, I think there are two kinds of responses. One of them is really to look at the politics of what is going on at the edge of democracy, and the edge of democracy is kind of where we are. I think we should sort of admit, in a sense, that the vision of a participatory democracy has to some extent failed, and its leaders no longer enjoy the trust of those who are supposed to elect them. And you know, just to talk about one of those processes, which I'm kind of surprised it hasn't been raised already, of course, is the challenge that is presented by the prospects of a Brexit. Now, if you look, as I have to, you know, with sadness and horror at a referendum which came out in favour of the UK leaving this huge, enormous project of the EU and saying, you know, we're going to go our own way from now on, it has to be understood partly in terms of that failure of government, the Brexit was not a rational decision. It didn't even take into account its own future best interests. It was a cry of anguish by a disenfranchised majority who no longer had trust in a minority who had governed in a corrupt and ultimately flawed way and delivered nothing that governance should deliver. How has governance reached such an impasse, and how could we possibly free ourselves from it? And I do think when you look at this new politics that now surrounds us, the two different ways to free ourselves from it, one actually is the emergence of a more popular-based politics and the emergence of people like Corbyn and Sanders and Pablo Iglesias and Yanis Varoufakis, people who actually engendered actually a spirit, a desire to participate in democracy in ways that the system, for all its wisdom, decided to try and crush as hard as it possibly could. But this is still a live movement. It's a movement that captures the imagination of people. It's a movement that captures, in particular, the imagination of younger people who kind of flock to it, looking for a new democratization, for a different sense of governance, one in which they can participate. And here is a real prospect for a different kind of politics. So and the second, just to finish, the second is like a little key. It's like, why, again, going back to that question, why has governance been captured by the interests of power and big business? One of the reasons is that what big business promises to government is revenue. It promises profits. It promises growth. It promises sometimes in underhand ways, but sometimes simply through a taxation system and a consumption system. It promises the ability to go on and govern. And governments are beholden to that. They have very little choice in that structure at the moment. But they could have that choice. They could regain that choice, in part, of course, by constructing the dimensions of a post-growth economy, but also by pulling back control over one of the most important aspects of that, the ability to invest in the social infrastructure of their own nation, in the welfare of their countries, to create a money system, in fact, which would allow that investment to be created. And the evidence here is just massive. When you look at the responses to financial recession and economic recession, there's a wonderful book called The Body Economics, which goes through case study after case study. And what it shows is that the impacts of recession, the impacts of a faltering economy, are dramatically different depending on the role of government. Where government has the potential for social investment, actually you can improve the outcomes even in the face of economic recession. When government sticks to its line of being tied to corporate interest and creating safety nets for the balance sheets of banks at the expense of social investment, then you are in a situation where well-being declines dramatically, a collapse. And that collapse is a problem for government because they then no longer have legitimacy. And time again, you see how that legitimacy is lost and how governments fall. And there is, in those two things, there is a real incentive for government to create the conditions for a meaningful sense of government, a sense of government that brings back the power of people into participatory democracy and severs the toxic link between government and corporate power.
Tim, this was almost like a speech, but we are not there yet. So let me combine giving the word to this is this blackout kind of thing after 1.5 hours to get Schick, with adding a question that I actually got from the audience. Die Frage, die hier auf Englisch gestellt worden ist, aber die ja schon...
A question that was asked in English, but that refers to the Greens' identity. I mean, how much can we bank on those who actually founded the Green Party, the many protest movements against Monsanto, for instance, against nuclear power? Would that be something to refer to against patriarchy? Sure. Well, in some areas, this can be successful, but it's not about going back. But it's maybe a way forward as well. I mean, the demonstration of people being fed up with things was a very important one, and it shows what the agricultural turnaround can be all about. It can be all about healthy food without destroying soils and animals or people. And I think there's a lot of power in that. And the TTIP issue is also another one. I mean, it's not about going back, but it turned out that a politicization took place. And I do believe that it is not a matter of coincidence, because the feeling, and I think that this has been nicely pointed out, that governments are just rushing for capital, and because of that, they have to be geared towards capital more than towards voters, and it raises the question about her mode of capitalization. And the question is, how can a globalization take place which would not push democracy to the second line, and we'll have to deal with that. TTIP is a fight against something which would even worsen the situation. But even if TTIP and CETA were not implemented, then the problem we've got now would not even be solved, and we would have to move on in this direction. But I don't think it is a coincidence that we've experienced this politicization in the face of TTIP. And I think we have to carry this on, raising the question as to what we do with the existing investment protection agreements that allow for investors' indictments and lawsuits, and we have to do something against it today, I believe. And how can we adopt rules for business so that democratic decisions are stronger than capital flows? Right. So this type of discussion doesn't actually have to have a finishing line, because they have to go on. So I've got two questions that I would like to raise up here, maybe up for the panelists to discuss. And then I'll open this up to the audience, and you can maybe make comments or pose questions. I find one remark very interesting, which is,
growth suffers from technological optimism, that's for sure, but some say that the alternatives, degrowth, suffer from psychological and sociological optimism. So they just believe that mankind is better than it actually is. What about?
And I think to some extent that's true. I mean, I think it's always been the case that we have to ask hard questions about how our economic structures work, but we have to ask equally hard questions about who we are as beings, as social beings, as psychological beings. My own sense is that of that is that when you start to look at that question in a relatively even-handed way, you discover something very, very quickly, that first of all, of course, that we are not all saints, that we have selfish appetites and desires. We are hedonistic, we are sometimes selfish. But then the second thing, and that's exactly what corporate capitalism would have us believe of ourselves, because it's what corporate capitalism needs to progress itself. It needs a group of selfish hedonistic people who will always be prepared to follow their own individual benefit over the benefit of everyone else. But it is such a thin, narrow conception of what it means to be human, and you can't find any defense for it really anywhere except in conventional economics. If you look in psychology or sociology or anthropology or religion or literature or poetry or artistry, or just ask ordinary people in the streets or in your own family, you will find a completely different sense of what it is to be human, in which, yes, of course, there's still some selfishness, but there's also concern for the other. There's a sense of futurity. There's an acknowledgement of the past. There's a recognition of the community. There's an honest, really integral desire to know what the crap we're all doing here, to have a sense of meaning and purpose. And none of these things can really be delivered through the thin, market-dominated capitalist vision of who we are as consumers. So it is not a question of being naive about who we are. It is a question of being informed about the richness of the motives that motivate human beings.
Okay. Eine ebenso konkrete Frage.
A very specific question has been raised as well, which has to play a role as well. Maybe one of the two of you could answer it. The commons economy, or the economy for the common good, maybe an alternative. Could you maybe explain to us what this means in two sentences? Well, this is a challenge to do it in two sentences, but I mean, this Christian Fermo and his book actually are very much linked to it and picks up on many of the ideas we've been discussing. So having a bottom-up democracy, decisions that are taken at a grassroots level, and the idea is that companies are just not putting on their balance sheet what they did in terms of economic performance, but also what they did for society. I think this is a good approach. And in Baden-Württemberg, we tried to make something of it. And I think there's a lot of power in such an approach. And I think some companies or some entrepreneurs are actually responsive to it and want to implement that in their companies. Or there are some banks that are founded where something is going on in that sense. And I think this is a good thing. This is one of the positive developments that we find. Well, now you can engage in the discussion, ladies and gentlemen. Maybe the first questions arrive as yet, but maybe this was rather more a remark than a question. The monopoly trends could be countered by a progressive tax on assets, on property. So this might maybe help us to regain trust. This goes into your direction. Yeah, but I think this confronts us with one problem. As long as we've got this power structure in order to push through a property tax to fight against the power structures, I think we have to find a solution. We have to sort this out. Okay, let's leave it at that. I think you raise your hand first. The microphone will arrive. My name is Thomas Faldecker. I work at the Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development. I share most of your ideas, but still a lot of things were missing to my mind. Right on the outset, Thomas Fatheuer said that our conventional economy was actually failing, and Tim Jackson then stated that we needed a new economy. But I don't think that this is the point. Our conventional economy did not fail, because the neoclassic economy encompasses all the points on market failure. And you can also read all the books in basic university courses. We've seen those external effects that were analyzed even back in the 1920s. So it's not about the failure of our economy, but it's about the failure of politics. And this was something that showed up very late in the discussion. The political processes of power, of influence, of lobby groups, of the whole networks between the industry, the military, and politics. And I think this is what it all boils down to. This is where the problem resides. But I don't think, I don't know how to counteract this, but I think we need to ensure that politicians are held accountable and to make public statements. And we need to really underpin how decisions are made by way of analyses. For instance, in succession law, disastrous decisions have been made. And I think politicians have to explain out loud whom their decisions benefit, and many of those things don't take place. You mentioned monopolies and all these stories. I won't really pick up on that, but what I was astonished about was what you said, Mr. Schick. You said that what we're missing are concepts for this transitional stage, but I don't think this is right. If you've got a planet with finite resources, it's just logical that these finite resources are broken down into consumptions that are sustainable in the long run. And this is where you have to start, politically speaking. And when doing so, you can basically reconcile growth and ecology. And you can do it on an individual level, for instance, by way of consuming fewer resources and less water, and impose progressive taxes. So we've got a specific endowment, which is very cheap, so that the poor can even afford something. And then starting from there, you would increase taxes massively, for instance, in the field of SUVs. So all these points have been discussed, and maybe you can comment on that, please. I'd allow for two more comments or questions, and then give it back to the panelists in the first row. And in the third row, we've got somebody. Maybe a lady? Do we have a lady here raising her hand? Where is she? Haven't seen lady. So girls, please come on. We're going to continue here. Thank you very much. I come from a field of agriculture. My name is Gunnar Demuth. Agriculture is a private thing in Germany. One of the founding fathers of the Greens, Baldur Springmann, once said that the agriculture was something that would benefit our community as a whole by way of its nature. Mr. Schick, could we discuss maybe how private soils and land can be? And I think private property and land is one of the main sources for me that land use in Germany looks the way it does right now. And if we want to change something to that, then this ownership issue has to be reorganized to link up with Tim Jackson, because ownership in soil and land is crucial. It's not just ownership in water, but also ownership in soil and land. Okay. Third row, please. And once a lady raises her hand, we'll hand the microphone to her. My name is Dominikus Vogel. I'm a social scientist. And at the moment, I work in a peace institute.
You do the language game you play with the partners you work with, and you also mentioned that you spoke about enemies out there somewhere. So for my work, who are the enemies I should invite? So I'm tempted to ask this question, and now I play my language game with you. Who are the partners or maybe friends I should invite to work with to work on the process of transformation? Because I think in the process of transformation, there are no enemies basically anymore. So that's my question. Yeah.
Okay. Kommen wir mal nach hier vorne zurück.
Okay, let's come back to the panel. Who is going to start? Private ownership in land. So start with a simple question. Yes, exactly. Let me start with this question. Yes, many of the classic economists taught us many things. We can learn from them a lot. That's true. A lot is out there. But what is sort of missing are models that consider the financial markets. Let me recommend Ulrike Hermann's recent book, where she really sketches very nicely that many things are out there in our textbooks, but certain things were missing, things that are used nowadays. And what I meant with this transitional model, I didn't talk about individual sectors or tools, but in a situation where we see a lot of capital, actually a lot of debts and high indebtedness, and where we have high demands towards return on investment. And if we now just step on the brake, I mean, that's very difficult. And we have seen that economies that do not have an appropriate transformation are often confronted with transitional collapses, and they did not end up in sustainable developments. Peter Victor wrote about Canada, but yeah, there's a first concept of a zero growth or low growth scenario, so how this could match and work. But for Germany, so far, there is no macroeconomic model that could show us how our economy, our concrete economy, could survive with 0% of growth without us entering into massive problems. And then the political actor, of course, has to ask, how can we master this? How can we achieve this? How can we do this? This is a gap, and it doesn't apply to everything but this macroeconomic low growth or zero growth perspective, which is missing for Germany. Now, non-profit, non-commercial land and soil. Let me go back to my history classes at school. If I remember it correctly, I learned at the time that the different German colonies, well, there was one actually in China that was run by the Navy and not by the army. and there was no private ownership to land and soil. That was the only German colony that was profitable and where Germans didn't have to pay. So that there are some indicators out there that show that could make sense. And real estate markets play a huge role during financial crisis. That is also something that we have learned. Yet, we now need to translate this into a new modern economy. What does that mean? Loans, we need to securitize land and soil. And it would be a little too fast to now just say, okay, we do everything differently. But we have to see that there are certain boundaries. We need certain boundaries when it comes to the concentration of real estate and properties. And we have to put an end to those speculatory loops and spirals. I think this is absolutely necessary.
I agree with that. I think there are three really interesting questions. The first, there were failures of policy. It's absolutely clear there were failures of understanding of what economics has said. Did economics really ever take into account that corporate power could disrupt the operation of the market? Yes, of course it did. Adam Smith said it 250 years ago. There are things that were failures of policy or misrepresentation of economics, but there are also, I think, failures of economics itself. And those failures encourage us actually to look deeper at the foundations of economics, particularly there was a failure in understanding the dynamics of markets, and in particular of financial markets. The kind of economics that policy has inherited makes a lot of the play of the freedom of market and the equilibrium of processes that actually were continually being distorted elsewhere for reasons that economics was not good at understanding, partly because it had a false impression of the rational behavior of people in the reality of it. So I think there are lessons both for policy and for economics. On the point about the ownership of land and the ownership structures, I would simply say I absolutely agree with you, and that is a particular lesson that's come out of the work of Thomas Piketty and his understanding of how wealth is inherited and accumulates, and in particular of how you have to have something in place that disrupts the accumulation that creates huge inequalities. And then Thomas's main suggestion there is a property tax, but one can clearly also think about radically different ownership structures, particularly in relation to the land and our experience of the land, even our experience of our own homes, which we like to think that we own. Actually, we don't. We're passing through them with a financial structure that involves debt at one end and capital accumulation at the other, which we will then use in ways which may or may not be constructive and may or may not be helpful to society. And I think in trying to save economics and the language of economics, what we miss actually is the depth of understanding that we need about those more radical aspects, like the structure of property relations and the distribution of assets and liabilities across society. On the question about the are there any more enemies, I don't think I used the word enemy, but I did express it in sort of slightly warlike terms by describing myself in no man's land. But I think the point about being in no man's land is you can't really afford to think about anybody as an enemy. So I absolutely kind of agree with you there that there are, you know, there are processes of reaching out and there are processes of understanding. What is the understanding that comes from the conventional investment markets? That they have to protect the value of shareholders. Who are those shareholders? They are the people that have pensions. Who are the people that hold pensions? They are us. You continually, actually, when you engage in those processes, come back to, they are us. That there is a sense of us being involved in that transformation and a process. And I think it goes to my point about language as well. Language is used as a device to distinguish them from us, this party from that party, and we have to some extent eschew that division of language and try to create the language that brings people into the dialogue exactly in the way that you're suggesting.
Okay, Tim, thank you. I actually, ich werde jetzt Auf Deutsch, die letzte.
Okay, here's the last question in German for the woman that is sitting to my left. What is your next book? Is that a mean question? Oh, well, I got a lot of encouragement. People encouraged me to continue to focus on the repoliticization of ecology and the reappropriation of the term political ecology. That is something that is really appealing to me. However, I have to admit the following. Well, we all have a certain understanding of politics. So if it works well, politics has to focus on commons, on human beings, on human rights. Politics have to be there for human beings and for people. And what really worries me also at a global level is to see how politics do not work anymore. Politics do not serve people anymore. There is such a huge intertwinement of political and economic powers, especially in the global south. And it's not only state companies that, of course, operate in important resource sectors. No, there is a high identity of interests. Having said that, we need to ask ourselves, how can we get back the autonomy of the political sector? Therefore, the term political ecology is so relevant and important. So how can we focus on this term and concept again in more detail? We need to develop something that we can put against this form of capitalism. All areas are now being priced. We even give a price to a leaf on a tree. We economize care work. We economize nature. We include everything into the capitalist utilization process, things that so far have been left alone. For instance, common rights of indigenous people. Goodness me, how can we put an end to this? That is a question that I would like to work on in the future. And it's not only me working on this issue. Many, many of our staff also work on this. And the only thing I can say is that the foundation tries to do search process. We try to do a lot in the area of the reappropriation of commons. How can a commons-based economy work? I mean, we have published many books. You don't have to write books every day. I mean, look at what we have. We have a lot of assets, many books. And one of our tasks is to organize search processes, quest processes. We want to support people who look for alternatives. And there are many books out there that are worth being read. And don't forget this one here. Read the book Inside the Green Economy. Yeah, thank you so much. Actually, the only thing I can say is enjoy the rest of the evening and look over there, please. This will be hung up downstairs. So thank you very much. Safe trip home. We would like to invite you to water and bread, because shrinking is also an important aspect of a different economy. Thank you.